Erik, man, thanks so much for coming on the show here today. It's good to have you back on. Could you start by just telling us a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, of course. First, thanks for having me back on. This is
our second show together. Yes.
My name is Erik Huddleston. I am a sports performance coach in the NBA currently. I am the highlight of my career, the former director of performance for IFAST. back in the golden days. Prior to that, and I think we talked about this on our last show, I just did a slew of internships, kind of all across the country, a wide variety of private and college athletics. So, that is, in short, that is my bio up to where I am at now.
I love it. I love it. And tell us, like, what's new? Like, obviously you did all the internships, you were at IFAST. Talk to me about the day-to-day now, bro.
Yeah. So my role has changed a little bit here over the last couple of years. So this is I am going into my fourth season with the organization.
Wow.
I spent my first 2 years as kind of a dual role between our G League team, which had just moved to Indianapolis at the time, from Fort Wayne, Indiana, which I know you're familiar with. Down to Indianapolis full time. We also started kind of utilizing our two-way players a little bit differently. So kind of had a lot of oversight with our player development and our athletic development guys. And now, I guess last season, the 23-24 season, I transitioned to a role that was basically full time with the Pacers, traveling, and now going into year two in that position. Aside from that, I'm old now. I think last time we did a show, I was 26 or 27. I had just started at IFAST. This would have been like 17 or 18.
Yeah.
I think I was actually like early 18.
Yeah.
That's my day to day right now is, I have a handful of guys that I train here. That is the majority of my job from like a time spent at work standpoint. And obviously we'll get into a lot of the things that go on outside of that, outside of just the face-to-face training with guys, but that is really, organizations continue to grow. That is really what my role here is to be, a sports performance coach with guys. I think we're getting away from the strength conditioning term, at least in the professional sport realm. And so that requires a little bit of a different skill set. Obviously we have, an abundance of resources here. So it's kind of combining a lot of those things and try to help the guys any way that we can.
I love it. I love it, man. And I will link to not only your podcast in the show notes, but also a handful of the other great NBA strength coaches that we've had on here, because I think it's illustrative and it covers a lot of the bases that I think are valuable, right? We talked about it before the show, like off-season training, in-season training, but I definitely want to take a little bit different kind of perspective and angle with you because we know each other well. And, I would just love to hear your unique perspective on this. So one thing I wanted to start with is, you'd been in a team environment before, right? Like you'd been at IU, you'd been at Texas Tech, but a good portion of your time had been at IFAST. So you're in a private sector gig and now you go into the NBA and the G League. So what was that transition like? What was that like, period, for you?
First it was nerve-wracking, I think.
Sure.
You get very comfortable in the environment that you spend the most amount of time in. And so for me, when I was at IFAST, I was on the floor at the end of my time there, so probably like the last year, I was training clients from 3 p.m. to 8 p.m. usually in the evenings in a semi-private style. So we've got, 3 to sometimes 5 or 6 people on the floor and interns. Sure. And that was 6 days a week for me. And my seventh day was typically program writing. So really everything else kind of evolved around that schedule for me.
Yep.
I think the thing that was the biggest kind of transition piece for me from then to now is that the majority of my time is spent around the sport. So when you're at IFAST, when you're at a private studio, you know, most of your time with athletes is going to be in that space. You know, we go from one person to the next person. It's another hour on your day. And by the time all those things get over, usually their activities, their sporting events, whatever they're participating in, those things are over by the time, you know, outside of your working hours. Yeah. So it's really difficult to see those things. It's really difficult to get a feel for what their schedule is like outside of those doors. But you do get comfortable in that environment. And I think that there's a lot of benefit to that, right? You have a lot of you have a lot of things that are constructed around you in a private session to for you to be successful as a coach and for them to be successful as an athlete, because they're choosing to come see you, right? Sure. Like their investment in you is tangible.
Yeah.
And so those things, I think, were a little bit of that carries over to the professional sports setting. But I do think that, you know, at the end of the day, you're still working with humans. I think that that is the easy part. The interactions that you have with people, the types of things that we're doing here, the principles of training, those are still the same that they were when I was working at IFAST. But I think that more often than not, the environment is really variable. You know, we have, I'm very comfortable in the weight room that we have here, the space that we have here in the building, and players know what to expect when they come in here. But other than that, we're in arenas and we are in hotels and, you know, I'm visiting guys in market that they live in when they're not with us in season. And so those things get to be, those are just challenges. They're not necessarily good or bad things that happen, but they are just, they're things that you have to consider when you're trying to work with another person.
Yeah.
I think that the other thing that I really, my biggest transition piece for me was just kind of the self-imposed pressure that I put on myself to be successful or have all the answers to everything here.
Sure. Yeah.
Like when I was at IFAST, I feel like most of the people that I worked with were asking me questions, and they, for good or bad, they wholeheartedly trusted the answer that I was giving them.
Sure.
Whether that answer was right or wrong, you know, I'm trying to give them my best effort, my best opinion.
Sure.
That's not always the case when you're working with people who are not seeking you out, I guess. You know, they have right. to work with me. The guys that I work with, I think that I'm fortunate that they want to work with me
right.
because we have an abundance of staff members here and they do have a little bit of choice in that. But really at the end of the day, the things that I'm asking them to do are not, not always willful on their end, I think is probably the best way to put it.
Sure. That's a great way to put it. Yeah. I think one thing that I've learned over the years, and I think you take this for granted if you work in a private sector, but you know your environment, right? Like you alluded to every day, you know, hey, I've got the squat ramps and the cables and the kettlebells, whatever stuff that you have put into your space, you know what you have and you know what you can access. And so one thing that I've learned over the years, and I haven't had to do it anywhere near as much as you or anybody else that works in the NBA or even in college for that matter. But man, sometimes when guys are like, hey, I want to go get a lift in, we're going to go to this facility, you can scope it out, man. I was working with guys earlier this summer, and I mean, it was the most Spartan training environment I've yep. ever seen, like lower level than any weight room I've ever been in. And it's like, okay, now let's see what you can really do, right? Because you can sketch out that perfect program. Oh, I want to do this and this and this and this. And you get there and you have literally 25% of what you expect. You better be creative. You better find a way to get the training effect. So it can be challenging, and it really, again, forced you to kind of think outside the box and be creative.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's more about what you do with the equipment that you have, I think, at this level than anything else. I think that people want to, like, we get away from the term sport specific because I think that implies that what the type of training that you're doing has to look like the sport. And I think in reality, what sport specific is that, at least from my perspective, you have to have a specific reason why you are doing an exercise that is going to elicit a response that they are doing in sport. And so while the two things don't have to look alike, I do have to have, and I think that this is, overlooked a lot of the time in professional sport, but I do have to have an answer for why I am doing everything. Their yes. time is their time in the NBA especially is very expensive. Like the per hour rate, if you were to break down what their paychecks look like, it is, you know, they're making a lot of money during the hour that they're with me.
Right.
And so that's valuable time that they could be spending doing something else. And basketball is usually the top priority. It depends on the type of season that we're in. But
sure.
But when you have those challenges, yeah, it you know, I need to be making sure that we are using our time wisely and in a way that I believe is going to produce the response that we want when they play.
Yeah. I love it, man. What were some of your biggest lessons when you get into the league? Or maybe here's a different way to think about it. Biggest lessons and or what didn't you expect getting started? Because if you guys don't know, I'm gonna give you a little props here. This guy has always been super prepared. He's always done his due diligence. He's always done his homework. So I'm sure beyond just the one and only Ty Terrell, you picked a lot of other people's brains before you took this job. What were maybe some things that you didn't expect, even based on all that, when you got into the league?
Yeah. So like you said, I do think that I had the advantage of having a network of people that had been around the NBA or been in the NBA and had literally been in the exact roles that I was going into when I made that transition. The biggest lesson that I think that I took away early on was the level of adaptability that you have to have and then the level of consistency that you have to bring or that they expect at this level. You know, you and I had kind of talked about in the private sector, how I think they think of us, clients think of us as cartoon characters, right? That you know, we show up and at IFAST, for those that don't know, like when I was there, we had a uniform. So we did literally wear the same thing every day. And it provided a level of consistency, I think, for clients that they really, really appreciated. And beyond what kind of apparel we were wearing, you also have a personality that needs to stay relatively consistent regardless of the type of stuff that you have going on outside of work. And so, you know, when you have people that come into a gym, they expect you to be on your game and provide them with some level of energy and some level of effort and some level of thought. And while that was the same here, I don't know that I expected all of the other, for lack of a better term, interferences to exist, I think, between me and accomplishing what I felt like I needed to accomplish with a player. So, you know, we talk about the schedule. You know, we played 100 games last year between. So our contract year in the NBA, our kind of annual cycle is July 1st to June 31st or whatever it is. During that time, I was on the road. I spent the night away from home between 130 and 140 times. A lot of the time, we are training away from the facility where we have all of our resources, where we have a comfort zone, all those things. Having adaptability, like we talked about, and being able to compartmentalize the things that you need to get done every day with each player, because it is different, right? I've only got between, depending on the time of year and who we have assigned, I've got between 4 and 8 players that I work with on a regular basis. And they all receive individual programming, which is just kind of like, I'm sure people listening are like, duh. Like that's only, you know, I had 90 clients when I worked in the private sector. Yeah, you should be able to individually program it. But right. When they're all on the same schedule, those things get lost sometimes. And so being able to be consistent with those things, being able to have a level of flexibility, because while I am consistent with the things that I bring every day, I don't necessarily expect the athlete that I work with to be consistent in the way that they present every day, right? Like they, right. As quickly as some of these players adapt to things, that adaptation is positive or negative. And so I have to be able to be receptive of the type of person from a personality standpoint, from a physical standpoint that I'm getting in the room every day, and understand that like they're going to need to be acute changes to the way that I either interact with them or the things that I'm programming for that day. So that is really, I am very, and you know this, like very regimented and planned when it comes to program writing. And so it is like, you know, a knife in my heart every time that I have to deviate from that plan, but I do understand the need to deviate from that plan because it wouldn't work otherwise. It wouldn't work. If I have a 40-minute lift scheduled and that gets trimmed to 20 minutes, what are the things that I am able to still do in that 20 minutes that could end up getting trimmed to 10? What am I going to be able to do during that time? And a lot of people, I don't think, are able to create a hierarchy of what they need to accomplish and what is going to be the thing that helps me accomplish the goal of this training program during this time. What helps move me closer to the end goal? And if it's only being locked in for 10 minutes with a player, I'll take that.
Right.
It's better than
nothing. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. And they're going to get my full effort and my full attention and the best educated decision that I can make during that time.
Yeah. So it's really interesting. You mentioned consistency, and I'm sure this is something that, you know, people have preached over the years, but that NBSCA event that I attended while I was out there, shout out to the NBSCA. They did a really good job. It was a really good event. But I think there were 7 or 8 speakers that day, and I'm not kidding, at least 3 out of the 8 mentioned the importance. Well, in fact, I know one was Andrew Paul, right, from OKC. Another was the GM from the Wizards that spoke. So at least those two, and maybe Jesse. But all 3 mentioned the need for consistency at this level and being able to buoy people, because look, at the end of the day, there's so much up and down in their life, right? And you got to think the ups and downs are even bigger, right? High stakes, high rewards. But man, as a coach or as an SNC coach, you know, an AT, physical therapist, whatever your role is, you've got to be able to buoy them. And when they walk in, they got to know what they're getting out of you every single day, because there's so much chaos everywhere else in their life. Yeah. Like if you can be that kind of stable, like consistent person that they see every day, that's what's going to make them really want to work with you and stick with you, because they know, hey, look, when I show up and I see E, I know how E is going to be. So even if I'm having a bad day, he's going to help get me going again.
Yeah.
I just think that's such an important piece.
That's huge. It's also, we're in an interesting position as a support staff in whole, because of the fact that I don't have any decision-making over basketball to them, right? They're getting paid to play basketball, and I don't have any, like, I'm not starting or benching players. I'm not deciding how many minutes they play. I'm not going over schemes with them on offense or defense. Those things are not in my wheelhouse. And so we have a certain level of relationship that essentially makes us, I was actually talking to one of our rookies about this the other day, is it essentially makes us a coworker with them rather than a coach with them, right? I have their interest in mind. I'm treating them individually. We both recognize that this person is part of a team. So we all need to work together. We all have like some of the goals for each individual player are not, from an organizational standpoint, are not necessarily their individual goals. Those might not be things that they want to work on, but I have to balance what the organization wants, what the player wants, what I see being, you know, an important piece for us to program around. And the combination of that thing, I think, is what, and the understanding from each department about what that means, I think, is what kind of propels an organization forward, is that we're going to treat you like an individual. We both understand that this is a team sport, so you have to melt into that a little bit, and you have to lean into that and have that be a strength for you. But everything that you're dealing with outside of here is outside of here. That's not, you know, this is the time where you're going to, I hope that you feel that I am treating you, thinking about what you're doing and actually programming well enough for you to get better in here, and let's take that as a win.
Yeah.
That's all I need.
Yeah. Yeah. I love it. I love that idea of being more of a coworker too, because it's a totally different relationship then. Right.
Right.
Versus if they look at you as like a coach or a basketball coach, then you're almost like a boss, right? Cause you're telling them what to do, or your, how they perform impacts if they play, all these other things, right? Their role on the team versus you're just there to support them. And I love that kind of mindset coming from strength coaches, because you know, you and I both know not every strength coach sees themselves as support staff. Some want to be the show, which is fine, whatever. But, you know, guys like ourselves, we know, hey, look, we're a part of a team here. We're part of the support staff, and it's our job to help the athlete go out and do on the court the things that they can do best.
Yeah. So I think if I can compare it to my experience in college, you know, college coaches, strength coaches, a lot of times they become the disciplinarian. And I think that, that guys who spend an extended amount of time playing basketball in college, they get used to, oh man, like here's this guy, like they're always on me about everything. And the coaching staff really relies on, in some cases, the strength coach to be that voice, to be a cultural voice, to be a, you know, we do things because this is the way that we do them. And there's a little bit of that that exists in the NBA. I've never been used as a disciplinarian here.
Yeah.
But I think that those things, they sometimes get in the way. They sometimes interfere with how receptive a player is to us, right? Like it's going to create interference. It's going to create a logjam of thoughts towards, is this person like actually interested in what I want to get better at, or are they just here to kind of like break me down? And I think a lot of times their experience in college is that they've been broken down.
Yeah.
That's not what we're here for.
Right. Right. And I think then there's a great talking piece or education piece right off the bat. Like one of the things that I always fight in basketball, it's the whole, oh, this guy's just going to try and get me huge. And try and get me on the record board. And so like one of the first conversations I always have is, look, if we need to put on size, that's great. I'm not going to make you a bodybuilder. If we need to get strong, that's great. I'm not going to make you a power lifter, right? Everything that I do from a strength and performance perspective has to carry over onto the court. So if you can kind of nip some of those objections in the bud before you ever get going, I feel like it just sets the expectation and opens the line of communication right off the bat.
For sure. For sure.
Okay. So I kind of alluded to this up top, but a lot of the shows that I've done, we've talked about off-season training, in-season training, but there's like a whole nother world to working in the NBA that I don't think a lot of people understand. And I think most people, especially if you're a casual fan and your team is done in April, you're like, oh man, so they just have like all summer off and just like work around, you know, their market. You and I both know that's not exactly how it works. And there's all these kind of almost distinct periods of time. So I would love to start with season is over,
yes.
Right? Hopefully later for us next year. I would love to see us done in June. That would be amazing. I even got for the sure. hat on. I got the hat on.
I know. I love it. I love it today. You are. It's bizarre that you are in Pacers gear right now, and I am wearing a plain T-shirt. I love it. Hey, I love it.
Somebody's got a rep. Okay. But in a perfect world, right? You play until, you know, at least May, maybe June. But then immediately you got to turn around and you're thinking about the NBA draft. So I would love to hear how your role shifts from, okay, I'm done with my guys. They're off doing their little break, getting away from the game and the market and all that. How does your job shift into now like this combine pre-draft type phase? So what does your role look like then?
Yeah, no, really good question, because I don't think a lot of people appreciate kind of the way that this unfolds once your TBD season is over, right? So my first 2 years here, we were not in playoff contention, so we really, like, we very clearly knew what the end date was, and that was our 82nd game of the season, right?
Right.
This year was not that at all. This was, and it was weird because, you know, being my first year traveling, I don't know what else to expect in that environment, but this is, we played in total 100 non-preseason basketball games. So 104 when you count preseason.
Yeah.
Our last game was April 27th. So we started training camp in October. We ended April 27th. The day after we finished with games, we had exit interviews with players, which is basically where we go over their off-season goals, make sure that we understand if they're not going to be with us in market, we understand like who they're working with outside of here, which we've already had those conversations by this point. Anyways, but we're having those conversations. We talk about their goals. We talk about what they thought went well this year. We're always having these conversations at an acute level on a one-on-one level with the players, but really this is a chance for our entire performance and medical staff to get together with one player and kind of be a sounding board for what went well, what didn't go well. What do you want to continue improving on? What are your plans for the offseason? All of those things. And so that happens the day after. We usually have our own staff kind of wind down meetings the day after that, because, you know, we've got to go through 18 players on that one day of just meeting after meeting after meeting. And so that gets to be a long day for them and for us. So we break down our stuff. But I think within 3 days, we had then our first pre-draft workout here in market. And so because we went late enough, I guess to go back, if you make the second round of the playoffs, you are then not required from a league standpoint to go to the NBA combine in Chicago. So if you're eliminated early enough, you still have the opportunity to go, but you are no longer required to work the NBA combine. So we did not go to the NBA combine. We were still full into our still season going, yeah, after that was over. Yeah. So we didn't end up going to combine. We also were in a unique situation this year because we didn't have any first round picks. So so in the prior 2 years, we had, I know what we had in 23. We had in 2023, we had 65 or 68 pre-draft workouts.
Wow. That's a lot.
So we had 5 draft picks last year. That was that. So we covered all the bases. You know, our top pick was at number 7. And I think our last pick was somewhere in the low or in the high 50s. So we had all over the board. We had workouts to do, and we had a lot of kind of boxes to check off from you know, a organizational standpoint of what are we looking for and what do we need to do. So we had a ton of pre-draft workouts. So that was our entire summer was,
wow,
was, you know, day after day after day, pre-draft workouts. And so once that, because we didn't have any of that this year, we had, I believe, 6 workouts. You know, we're all looking at kind of second round players. So all of them are going to fall kind of in the same skill set, the same, you know, kind of wheelhouse for each other. And then we had the draft, and then we go into Summer League. And so, you know, Summer League is and you were out there, it's butted up right against the draft. So we're literally getting to know these players. And days later, they're coming to a Summer League camp with us. And days after that, we're, you know, flying out to Vegas with them so that they can play in games with us. So it really is I'll fill in some of the gaps in between that. But
yeah,
it is, I think that people do get the idea that this is a school schedule. You know, we have a season and then we have just break. And while the schedule is not as rigorous during the off season as it is in season, we're still, you know, I am still gone all the time. I'm still in the office all the time. Like there are things we have to do and we want to be successful. And so I think we're all willing to put in that work, but it is not off during the summer. I'm very fortunate that I have guys that want to stay in market with us. You know, we've both said this before, but Indianapolis is not the summer destination for most millionaires.
Right.
And so this is like the fact that these guys want to stay here and want to continue doing the work that we're doing is a huge testament to our medical staff and our performance staff and our coaching staff. And so I feel very strongly that we play a big role in their development during the off season. So that time that we spend with them is really, really important for me. And so I'm willing to put in that time. I'm willing to fly out to cities that, you know, that players live in while they're on vacation or if it's their home market to be able to work with them. So that is, I will always push for that. I'm not somebody who feels like I'll talk to whatever coach that you work with in the off season and I'll just, you know, I'll see when you get back.
Right.
I have situations where that's necessary and I do that stuff, but like, even if you are in Washington DC for the entire summer, I'm going to come see you and I'm going to check to see like what you're doing and have a face-to-face interaction with your coach and have you know that I'm involved in the things that you have going on and I am invested in your progress as a player. So that doesn't allow me time to just be like, everything's, you know, I'm good.
Right,
I'll see you when you come back.
Yeah.
That can't be how this operates.
Yeah. Well, and like you said, it isn't, you are showing your investment, right? You're showing the athlete that, look, I could, right? If you're going to be somewhere else, if you're going to be in your home city for 3 or 4 months, you've got somebody we trust, I could absolutely just sit back and do nothing. But no, I am going to invest in you. And if you want me out here, great, I'll be here. If not, I'll probably be out here a little bit anyways, just to check in on you. But again, that's where the entire relationship is different for a lot of reasons, right? The money involved, the power dynamic involved. But again, just showing that regardless of all that, right? I'm not going to have my thumb on you. This isn't high school or college, but I am. I'm going to continue to show my face and show my investment in you. And I want to see you succeed. I would assume you do that in the off season. That goes a long way and builds a lot of social capital to when you get into the season, they're like, oh yeah, okay, let's go.
For sure. You should see how guys change when you go into their hometowns and you meet people that they associate with. Like a lot of, you know, people aren't just allowed to walk into our practice facility. So right. A lot of times you don't see any of the people that our players interact with outside of this building. And so the fact that you get to interact with them in their environment, it does open you up to who they are outside of the facility, who they are outside of basketball. You know, it's bizarre just the changes that people make when you allow them to sleep in. Like if I'm going to your home market, I don't want to see you before 10 o'clock in the morning. Like that's what we do during the season. So don't, like, I don't want you to try to just get things done early in the morning for the sake of the grind. Like sleep in, take your time. Like, I'm not worried about those things.
Right.
I want you to get the most out of this. And I also want you to, like, when I'm in a city for a specific player, I'm here because, you know, the team is invested in you. And the team is sending me out to make sure that you are getting the best care that I can provide. So let's set up the constraints to allow you to get the best care that I can provide.
Yeah. I love it, man. I love it. Okay. So like you alluded to, we go from regular season, postseason, if you're lucky, into pre-draft, combine. Now, like you said, you get like a week. I think this year it was legitimately a week.
Yeah.
Was it Wednesday, Thursday, or Thursday, Friday? And then the next week they report for camp, right?
Yeah.
For like summer league camp. So what does your role look like then?
Yeah. As we transition, as we bring new players in, we start to kind of fill out that summer league roster. So, you know, for people that don't know, we had the privilege. I've never worked with Dakota before, but shout out Dakota because we got to share this might be the first time outside of IFAST that you and I have ever shared an athlete. I know.
Pretty cool.
It was really cool. And so you get, you know, we bring in new players. You get to know, obviously there are players from an organizational standpoint that they are invested in. We have players from our full-time Pacers roster that are being assigned to play summer league. We have players that we are drafting or bringing in free agency, and this is their first exposure to our organization, to how we do things here and the system from a basketball standpoint. And then we have players that management is interested in, but they're kind of trying to gauge their level of interest or what this player's skill set is, or maybe they haven't seen this player play enough. And they want to get more eyes on them. So that is really like you have the gamut of things, of types of players that you run through when you look at summer league. But once that schedule with them starts, basically we do, it becomes much more of a transition period in a lot of ways from college for most of the guys. A lot of them have either played overseas or they're coming to us straight out of college. And so, this year, because we hired a full-time strength coach for our G League team, Jake Smith, Jake and myself kind of lead that summer league staff here.
Yep.
From the performance side. So we're able to, you know, quickly take guys through assessments if we haven't already seen them during the pre-draft process or from our G League team or from our NBA team, take them through some of the assessment that we do here, put together some programming. Now the programming is mostly group oriented during the time that we have them here. And that's simply out of a necessity from a scheduling standpoint, because
how many guys do you have? Like 15?
We had 15 guys on the summer league team. We had 16 or 17 that attended camp with us for summer league.
Yeah.
So that's a lot. And they are all, basically they come into the weight room on a rolling basis. So we try to get the lowest hanging fruit, but we also use this as the time to, from a weight room standpoint, build some movement literacy, build some vocabulary with them, Have them be exposed to a lot of different things that hopefully they are going to be exposed to when they're with us for the whole season. And so a lot of these, it's kind of reframing things, but also giving them reference points for when we say split squat, that they generally know what that setup means for them individually. And then we go around and we make changes to how that setup is for them. So it does, it's not individualized from a programming standpoint, but it is individually coached. And I think that that is an important kind of way to distinguish those two things, because we're not trying to have everybody do the exact same thing just for the sake of ease on our end. We're trying to have them have the highest level of benefit from the exercises that we're providing, and then build a vocabulary with them from there. So that is always such an interesting time, because I would hope that you would be able to ask any of the players that we have on our summer league team, and they wouldn't know the organizational hierarchy of whatever their perceived importance is. Yeah. There are players that don't play for the first four games of summer league, and they might only play the fifth. And I don't want their experience to be any less than any of the other players that we have in the building here. I want them to leave here feeling like they had time with each of us, feeling like they had a personal relationship with each of us, feeling like they got better from the type of training that we were doing, or they learned something that if they're not with us going forward, that they're able to take with them moving on to wherever basketball takes them going forward.
Yeah.
So it's really, really important for them to know that we are available for them anytime. A lot of the things that we do when we're actually in Vegas are optional type of training sessions. And so the fact that we have such great attendance with those type of things tell me that players are receptive to what we're doing, and they appreciate the fact that we are treating them so with the same type of care that we would treat any of the starters for the Pacers.
Yeah. So a couple great take homes here. Number one, regardless, high school, college, professional, private sector, creating a culture, right? And showing that everybody is valuable and important. I mean, that's such a great take-home point. And I think that's something I know that I've tried to do at IFAST, right? Because not everybody is Glenn Robinson or Ed Sumner and has, you know, played numerous NBA seasons. I do my best to try and treat all my guys the same, regardless of the level, where they're at. So I think that's just a huge, huge way to differentiate yourself from other people, right? Because you know as well as I do, there's some places there is very clearly a hierarchy. And look, sometimes it has to be that way. But I think the more you can treat everybody equally, the better it's going to be received. And again, it just shows the culture and what you're trying to build within the Pacers. So that's very cool. The other thing, I think in those situations, like you said, sometimes, hey, it's a whiteboard workout. You know, like here are the things and we're going to squat and split squat, whatever. But I think this is also a great time, like you alluded to not only coach things individually, but like coach them the way that you would like to see them coached. Because when you've got 15 guys, all from different backgrounds, different ages, shapes, sizes, injury histories, if you can just teach everybody to squat relatively well or split squat, teach them what you want them to feel, you know, because everybody's done push-ups their entire life. But you teach people to do a push-up a certain way and they're like, oh my gosh, I feel my abs. Or they squat a certain way and they're like, oh my gosh, I've never felt my quads. Or my knees always hurt. Now I just feel my quads and I feel like, you know, I'm building muscle. Like, it's such a great time to distinguish yourself from all of the other coaches that they've had prior to that point.
Yeah. I mean, you make a great point there. We call exercises names to allow them, like, it's the ease of communication, right? But like, if I'm coaching a split squat and I'm having them hold a goblet position kettlebell or dumbbell, versus having them offset the weight, versus having a cable pull them forward, versus having a cable attached, you know, a cable attached to a 3D strap that's pulling their hips back and they're facing away from the cable. Those are all very different exercises with very different outcomes and goals and purposes for each individual person. So we call them a split squat for the ease of being able to say, okay, I recognize this movement and that's what I'm calling that. Not the same thing though. So being okay with the fact that like, okay, we're all going to start on this movement that we know that you have to be able to accomplish for us going forward. But let's like see what works best for you or what we think is going to benefit you the best in the long run. And once they know that you have put thought into what they're doing and you can explain why they're doing it a certain way, and you can also make them feel successful in those positions. A lot of these guys aren't necessarily good in here, right? Like, this is not their comfort zone.
Right.
And so when you improve the way that something looks and feels, but it also has some level of transferability to what they're doing on the court and they can feel that action.
Yes.
What else can I ask for?
No, it's a wrap. And you talk about buy-in, like buy-in is through the roof then. And here's another thing that I've always thought about. I know you've always done a great job of this is even if you have the whiteboard workout, right? And let's say you took all 15 guys through the exact same thing. Hey man, but then that's where you watch somebody do something and now, hey, let me give you this goblet position instead. Or, oh no, I'm seeing you do this. Let me give you that offset with the cable. Again, that's where it allows for dialogue, right? It allows them to feel certain things, but you can kind of micro progress and change the exercise over the course of that 7 to 10 day period. Because like, look, everybody wants to hear, no, you wrote 15 customized workouts for this 7 to 10 day period with every guy. It's like, it's not possible, right? The constraints are too great, but you can progress within that 7 to 10 day period as you get more eyes and more reps with these people. Like, hey, let's have you do this. Let's have you do that. So now your whiteboard workout that started off as 6 exercises is maybe the same 6, but you've tweaked it and modified it to every single guy. So they get something uniquely beneficial to them out of it.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's also the, like Jake and I met every morning when we were in Vegas and we're going to work with guys. And we went over, you know, not only what we're looking at in each exercise, what are the things that we want the athlete to take away, but also how we layer those exercises to make our job easier in whatever the goal was that we're looking at. So if we're working on vertical displacement for one day, I want to look first at like let's do something that is ground-based that is going to allow them a little bit more hip flexion, right? So let's get them into a position that is supportive, that allows them. So if we're doing like a reverse crunch for our A exercise,
right,
let's look at what that reverse crunch looks like. Let's look at what their ability to counternutate their sacrum is for them to pull their knees towards their chest. And then let's go to the next kind of less supported variation of that. So if it's just getting into a tall kneeling position and sitting back to your heels and then pushing up or doing some kind of row or reach in that position, then we're teaching them how to displace their body mass up and down over their center of mass. And then it's standing up and going into something that allows them to go kind of tie all of those things together to kind of allow that to be a full compound movement. So now, okay, your heels are on the heel board. We're going to actually go through a goblet squat now. And once they understand what that A exercise, what the need is for that, then those things start to fall into place. And then I don't have to spend as much time over talking to you about over explaining, over cueing what the point of the final exercise is. You already know that you have to do the same things that you did for the first 2 exercises on this. We're just going to add another layer there. So we spent a lot of time going over those things and how they layered to kind of get us the result that we wanted on the back end. And I think that was really important.
I love it. Okay, so one thing that I think everybody that's listening is probably interested in, I know I'm always interested in this as well, is, you know, a lot of times we focus on, when you're at IFAST, the 3 to 8, right? You're on the floor, or you're in the gym and you're coaching your players. What goes into your job outside of coaching? What other roles and responsibilities do you have on a day-to-day basis?
Yeah, that's great. I'm going to give a couple different kind of I'll work up to my current position, but I'll start at where I started. I don't think that the G League is the entry level position for the NBA. And that's not to say that you have an entry level skill set, because I think a lot of people misinterpret what that means. I think I looked at the survey that they did with G League coaches last year. The average age is close to 30 for a G League performance coach. So I think it was somewhere in the 28 range. I know that Jake right now is the same age that I am. And I was 28 when I, 28 when I came into the G League here. That doesn't mean that was my first job out of college. And that doesn't mean that if it is your first job out of college, that's wrong either. But the expectation is that, you are going to you're going to do whatever you have to do to kind of help the organization. And so while your title might be strength conditioning coach or sports performance coach or whatever it is, the resources at the G League, while they are similar to a lower level Division I college, the staffs are much smaller and they are much less funded than what the NBA is. And so sure. the responsibility is huge. At one point I counted in my first year, I had the same responsibilities as 9 people that were paid full time by the Pacers. So I had the same job wow. responsibility. So wow. I did all of basically all of our travel logistics while we were on the road. So I would do, let's checking guys in at the airport because you're flying a commercial flight. That is making sure that they have, that all of our equipment bags get through security. That you know, I've contacted the bus driver at the city that we're getting into, so they know where to pick us up at the airport, to contacting the front. Like, I would hand out keys when we got to the hotel for each player. Gosh. So they just hand me a stack of keys and I had to hand all those out. I was in charge of our pregame food, our postgame food. So we didn't travel an equipment manager in the G League. So I was in charge of all of our uniforms. So when our uniforms needed to be washed after a game or when we had practice, all of that stuff was me.
Oh my!
And gosh. Then on top of that, I'm doing training and also trying to develop a skill set in a league that I really wasn't familiar in. So at the G League level, it is kind of like the other duties as assigned really do become a good part of your job for the end season portion of that. And the rest of the year, I'm spending time with the NBA team and they have people that do all of those things. at where I'm at now, what's different about that now is that NBA staffs are huge. And so everybody has kind of clearly defined lanes that they stay in from a professional standpoint or from a job expectation standpoint. So really, outside of coaching, what I spend my time on is, besides projects that are assigned to me, is mostly my time. And so what I've chosen to do with that is to use a lot of the time that I'm saving now that I wasn't saving the G League to do professional development or find other ways to develop a skill set that maybe is not, maybe doesn't exist yet in the NBA. So an example of that is so we played 100 games last year. I watched at minimum 100 basketball games 3 times. So, wow. So when I say 3 times, I watched it. We have something called Second Spectrum. So it's a camera system that exists in every arena in the league. And it, within 90 minutes of the game, provides you with completely cut video of the entire game. And not only that, you get the broadcast angle, but you also get above basket view. So every, you know, they show the camera during free throws or whatever, it's above basket. So I can watch the broadcast angle, or I can watch from behind on defense, from in front of you on defense, from behind you on offense, from in front of you on offense. So the first time I watched the game is obviously live. And so that for me, because I do love basketball, I'm just going to watch the ball movement basically. And I'm just going to see what's going on and I'm going to kind of live in that moment. But after the game, what I start to do is when I rewatch the game, I'll cut film of, and I have folders that hold each of these, but each player that I have good offensive possessions, good defensive possessions, things. And when I say good and bad, I'm looking mostly at the movement that occurred, not necessarily the basketball action. So whether you scored or whether you got scored on, I don't care. But did you make a mistake that I think could have been fixed, or was there something there from a positioning, from a level changing standpoint, from a decision making standpoint that I think that our training has some effect on? And I'll cut those clips and pull those into a separate file. So I do those at different angles, and those angles are really, really helpful because a lot of times you can't see things live or from the broadcast angle that you want to work on.
Yeah,
but those anterior and posterior views from above the basket are clutch, and they provide you with a lot of, especially from a change of direction training standpoint, they provide you with a lot of information. and then the quality that you're getting, you can easily add, you know, if you're using something like an iPhone, you can easily add markers on top of those that help the player visualize. So that really has opened up a door for me to have a conversation. And like we talked about earlier, be able to connect what we're doing in the weight room, what we're doing when, you know, from the performance staff, when we get players on court, and then what they're doing and how we can bridge that gap better. And so it's really created this very, I think, kind of, it serves everybody well, but it's created a dialogue for us to be able to say, you know, we're not just here to make you bigger, faster, stronger. We're here to help you be able to do, like you can't keep your big toe from rocking off the ground when you're going into a cut. And so it's really affecting the way that you're pushing out of this cut. And so we're going to do X, Y, and Z to help make sure that doesn't happen again, or we're going to help you find, you know, a resource that allows you to be better at that. So that has opened up a ton, and it's also helped me learn. It's just more hours that I spend looking at the way that the guys that I work with do things, right? Like, you can never know your athlete well enough. And as much time as I spend with them in the weight room, I can't be 100% focused in what each player is doing on the court at the same time. So it does allow me to kind of bucket each individual thing that I need to work on with them.
Yeah. That's so interesting. Yeah. One of the things that I think it was Carlo Alvarez said on this show years ago, because Carlo worked in, I think he worked in the Reds organization for a while. He worked in the Pirates organization for a while. And he was at one point, I think maybe when he was in Pittsburgh, he was overseeing like 16 coaches, right? Yeah. Amongst all his minor league affiliates. And he's like, look, like, good coaching just gets you in the ball game, right? Yeah. Like, that just gets you in the door. That's not going to get you a job. Like, you have to do at least one other thing at a really high level. And he said, like, one guy that he had, like, okay, he was a great coach, but he was also just like a monster with Excel, right? When Excel was like, you know, they needed everything in Excel, like all the stats, you know? So for you, you found something else, right? And they talked about it again at this NBSCA event. It's like, I talked about it with Mike Ure a couple of weeks ago on the show. It's like, hey, if you're not like a dual credential, like a PT strength coach, where you have the medical side, you got to have something else, right? Yeah. So maybe it's your ability to translate the sport to the weight room. For somebody else, it's the ability to marry being a strength coach with being a sports scientist, right? It's like, you have to be able to connect the dots or unify some things. You have to bring something else to the table beyond just being a great coach. Yeah. And I think that's one thing that not enough people respect.
For sure. Athletic development still has so much room. Athletic development is still finding its niche, I think, in the NBA. I think that we are, and I say we as, like, you know, not this organization necessarily, but the league-wide impatient, I think, with the type of development scheme that we're supposed to have, because the players, when they come in the league, are already so highly paid, and they're expected to kind of like make this very clean progression. And when things don't go exactly that way, we're not really appreciative of all the variables that can affect something like that. So, you know, there is a ton of room for us to be able to kind of bridge the gap and understand that simple things can still make a really, really big impact in what your athletic capabilities are in the long run. And we are, it's really meaningful at this level to make actionable change, because you're already dealing with people who are thought of as the top like 1% of basketball players in the world. So any type of worthwhile change that you make is magnified in this environment. Sure. And so when you have players, and I think that they talked about this at the NBSCA, because I talked with another coach who was there, and the amount of value that you can create because NBA rosters are becoming so kind of two tiered, right? You have players on each team that make a ton of money and are really close to their development ceiling, usually already by the time that they make that second or third contract. Yep. But you also have players at the bottom that are really, they're the turnover players that organizations aren't really committed to, but would like to see something like, what would like to see their situation improve.
Right.
I love being a coach that can help those players either be help them increase their own stock in our organization, or help them increase their stock someplace else, or be a value add to what we do from an athletic development standpoint. And so I think that you look at our program over the time that I've been here, and I did the math on this not long ago, but it's like, I think I've had 12 players in 3 years that have had some kind of like call up situation in their career. So whether it's going from a full-time G League player to a two-way, or from a two-way to a full roster NBA player, those are success stories. Those are people that, for sure, that they're creating, you're helping them create a foundation from an earning potential to make money for the rest of their career. And you're also helping the organization because you've added value in a place where they didn't necessarily expect value. And so for me, that's a huge deal. And I think that we play a large part in that because we are around these guys every single day.
Yeah, I agree. Okay, so I got one more kind of big question, and then we got some lightning round stuff to finish off with.
Cool.
So one thing I'm always interested in, because obviously I have like my little role. And so like, if you and I share an athlete, right, you and I go back and forth and you say, hey, I found this and, you know, here's what we're working on, and vice versa. But I'm always interested, is there any sort of collaboration? Like if somebody gets traded, right, or somebody comes to you, they were a free agent signing, like how much interaction is there? And I'm sure there is probably variability amongst teams, mm-hmm, and organizations, but like, how does that work? Is there some like co-op sharing going on?
Yeah. It varies a lot because there is no set standard for that type of thing, right? Like we have, there is a medical record that exists in the NBA that is shared between teams. And once a player, once there's a transaction that occurs, that player's information from a medical history standpoint is shared with the team that they are going to. The reality of that is that there is no standard for how much information is on those things and the reliability of the information that you're getting from an EMR. So, teams don't have to, there's a little bit of a gray area in terms of like what is put in an EMR and what we deal with agents and we deal with organizational hierarchies, just like any other kind of company. So, what gets put in those things, you have to verify a lot of times by having a communication with the other person. From the performance side of things, there is no set standard for what must be shared between performance staff. So when we have player transactions, I think that anybody from another organization that I've interacted with knows that I will send you programs. I will have a phone call with you. I will meet with you and the player if the player wants to meet. I will cover all those bases to make sure that that player is taken care of no matter what the situation is. That they're not always asking for that type of thing in reality. And so, right, so you always make the offer. But that doesn't mean that that's reciprocated. And it hasn't been reciprocated sometimes when we've made, we're requesting information from other teams. And so, we do our due diligence. I think that the medical side definitely has more formalized conversations on that type of thing than the performance side does. But that's because those procedures are kind of in place to make sure that the trade going through is legal from a league-wide standpoint, right? You can't trade a player if there's undisclosed medical information. They have to pass physicals, all this stuff. So because of that, it creates some continuity there. On the performance side, I think something that would surprise most people is just how different it is organization to organization. I don't think we are still a relatively new field within professional basketball.
Yeah.
We're looking at like 25 years of being involved really in basketball players lifting weights, which is just bizarre to say.
Right.
But because it's still relatively new, and because each team is selective about kind of what they think of as being proprietary or what they think are trade secrets, what they think are the ownership and leagues are very protective of that thing. We have to be thoughtful about the type of information that we provide for other teams, but they're also doing the same thing with us.
Yeah.
I want to benefit the player. I just want the player to know that, like,
right.
Like, I want you to go succeed someplace else. If you end up someplace else, here is what we did with this player. That shouldn't be a secret. The player should be able to hopefully tell you the things that they liked about right. training and things they didn't like about training. So, like, what's the difference if I share with you, you know, another program? There's no, I'm not inventing exercises here that no one has heard of. So,
right. Yeah. And I just think that part's interesting, right? Cause like, even if I gave, which I do, like whether it's you or Memphis or other people that I've worked with over yeah. the years, I'll literally send you the programs. Here's what I'm doing. All the coaching cues, everything. That doesn't mean it's going to be immediately translatable, right? It's not right. like you're reading a book. Cause even if you read a book, right, we could read the same book and we interpret things differently. Exactly. Same thing with programs. So it's like, I don't know. Granted, I probably live in this like hunky dory woo woo world where I want everybody to get along, but it's like, man, it's like ultimately you want the athlete to be successful. And if you have their best intention at heart, they'll be able to say, hey, look, like, here's what I did with E. I really liked it. You know, here are the things I'd like to see going forward. And hopefully that will lead to just better conversations, you know, and better communication going forward.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm not like, even when you and I share information like that, it's never in the, through the lens of like dictating what you do with the player. It's to say, this is what we've been working on. And even when we get information from our medical staff about a player that comes in, usually what their recommendation is, we think that they need to work on X, Y, and Z, and they kind of leave it to us to make yes. a decision about how to do that. And really, that's what we're trying to do, is provide the other invested parties with information that is going to help them make a decision about what to do with the person that they're working with. That's yeah. it. I don't care how you get things done, because everybody, even within our own organization, everybody has a different skill set. Everybody has a different lens and experiences that they view things through. So it would be a disservice for me to try to tell you exactly, like a cookbook, how to do everything that you're doing with this person. It doesn't make sense.
Right. Right. I love it. Yeah. I don't know. I just always think like the time you have the most friction is when you say, I need you to do exactly this.
Yeah.
Right. Versus like you said, here are some general things I'd love to see out of the programming. Or maybe here, I'll even take this, right? Coming from a medical person, whether it's Bill or Eric or other medical people I've worked with over the years. Like if they've got like, hey, here are like two or three hard stops for me. I want you to avoid these, and they can give me rationale. Okay. Right. And that's right. where, hey, hopefully you have a pretty broad skill set or a broad exercise pool that you can choose exercises from. But yeah, it gets really hard when somebody's like, I want you to do exactly this. And they like give you the program. Cause then it's yeah. like, you just don't feel like you have any authority over it, right? Or any yeah. agency over the program.
I mean, those conversations should at minimum open up a conversation, right? If Bill is telling you, hey, don't do push-ups with this guy. My expectation from you is a response that's like, okay, can we talk about why a push-up wouldn't be appropriate for this person? And then right. if the goal of the push-up is for them to have dorsal rostral expansion at the top of the push-up, what other activities can I do that are not contraindicated for them that we right. can get this done through? And that should be the type of conversation that we're having a back and forth with.
Yeah.
It's not just don't do this, you know, do this one. It can't exist like that, because we're yeah. not seeing things from their lens and they're not seeing things from our lens.
Yeah. That's a great way to put it. Okay. So last but not least, I got a lightning round for you. A couple questions here. I want to start with, what is your favorite NBA city to visit?
Oh man. I love Dallas.
Mm.
And it's like the arena is nice. The city of Dallas itself is so clean and yeah. has great weather usually. It is for a downtown metropolitan area, it's got a lot of stuff to do. They've got a great like walking trail. If you're ever in Dallas, Katy Trail is this kind of citywide path, and I can't remember how long it goes, but it is fantastic. My number two though is New Orleans, and I think it's just because it is so different than any other city that we go to.
Yeah,
you can see. You know, the French Quarter is beautiful, but like you also have Bourbon Street, which is just a different animal. And it's just a very interesting place that I think is so different than Indianapolis that it becomes appealing for a couple days at a time. Yeah, I can tell you what is not.
Yeah.
I can tell you what's not my favorite.
Yes, please.
Las Vegas.
Really?
Yeah, no, I think I did the math on this. I've spent almost 2 months in Vegas over the last 3 years. So
yeah, that's fair.
It's too much.
So that was going to be my next question, is you have to give me one redeeming thing about Vegas, because every person I talk to, now keep in mind, if you're listening, think about where these guys are at when I see them. If I go to Summer League, right, they've just been grinding literally since like August or September. I'm seeing them mid-July. They're getting ready to actually get something of a break, hopefully, but now they're stuck in Vegas for 7 to 10 to 14 days. So yeah, these guys are just road weary, tired, can't find a vegetable. That's always like the running joke, like it's so hard to find vegetables. what's something redeeming about Vegas for you?
Yeah, I'll do two. I think that first and foremost, being able to see the young guys, like I'm always so excited when we bring in new young players and kind of seeing what they provide, especially when I feel like we really got like a steal in the draft like we did this year. I feel like seeing what they bring and seeing them outperform kind of the immediate expectation is really, really exciting. The other thing is just like having pool time. I don't feel like I ever get just like a relaxing, sunny pool time when I'm here in Indiana. So like I am incredibly fair skinned and I don't see the sun for like, you know, 9 or 10 months out of the year. So having a little bit of time in the sun, I think it's just restorative for me at this point. So
you're literally just like rejuvenating yourself every day you're there.
Yeah. Yeah.
What's the first day like at the pool? Will you give yourself 20, 30 minutes? Like you can't give yourself too long, can you?
Yeah. So I think I learned better this year. Usually what I do is I try to quickly counter my normal skin tone. So I will just not put on sunscreen and I'll lay out for like 30 minutes and just I'll be red the rest of the week. This time I actually like, I kind of slow cooked it. I put on the SPF 30. SPF 30 really hurts me because it's like anything above 15. I'm like, man, I'm going to sit out here for a while. So I slow cooked it this year. I think my skin is thankful for that in the long run.
Yeah.
But I usually try to go overboard the first couple of days because I'm just, I haven't seen the sun at all.
Yeah. No, that's fair. Number three, you had mentioned you do get an off season. You do get a little bit of time. What's your plan here? What's your vacation this year?
Yeah. So fortunate because I'm going to spend some time in Colorado, give a little off time. Hopefully stay away from crowds and larger cities for a little bit and just kind of disconnect with, you know, friends, have a little bit of time there. I think that I have been really bad about that in previous years because I will associate in my head being on the road with being like taking time away from home. So when I do get time off, I just want to stay at home.
Right.
And I'm going to try to be better about being diligent with the types of making myself get out of my comfort zone and go do things that I normally wouldn't do because I know that I'm going to be better for it in the long run. I just need time away. I need time to, as selfish as it sounds, like time for me, basically.
Absolutely. No, it doesn't. And I think anybody that's coached for any extended period of time knows like we're in a very servant type of role and position, and that's okay, right? It's kind of what you sign up for, but you need those times away to unplug, disconnect, and just kind of get your own center back because it makes you a better coach.
It's crazy because I'm already having like FOMO about not being here for a week, and I'm like, I shouldn't be feeling that right now.
Right, right. You haven't even left yet.
No, I know. I know.
You haven't even left yet. Yeah, for sure. Okay. Last but not least, what's next for Erik Huddleston?
Yeah. I think I want to, you know, like I mentioned earlier briefly, I want to continue to develop, you know, what my lane is here. You know, I see myself being here for as long as they'll have me. Naturally, that comes with like progression of what your roles and responsibilities are. And I think that is like, that's already changed for me every year for 3 years.
Right.
And so I'm looking forward to this next season, but I'm also looking for kind of the opportunities in the past. I think that, you know, this, but like, it's, there are so many, when people think sports performance or strength conditioning, there are so many avenues that they can go down that are areas for them to explore, for areas for them to grow. And it's hard to kind of focus on one at a time and feel like you have a great level of experience in any one department before you move on to the next.
Sure.
And so I'm really looking for, how do I tie things together better? How do I contribute to the overall success of the players that I work with and the organization at large? And where do I fit in going forward? And what kind of path can I create for myself, whether it's through having a better lens of basketball understanding, or having a better, a lot of coaches, and I heard Mike say this on your podcast, but like, we don't go to coaching clinics. We don't go to basketball specific clinics.
Yeah.
Those things are important. I do think that like, it gets kind of undersold because we are expected to stay in our lane. And the reality is that like, our lane is improvement in basketball.
Yes.
And so if I can add to that through the weight room or through some kind of gray area that we create with how skill development is done, whatever that is, I want to contribute to that. And so I think trying to find those things, I'm also, obviously I keep up to date with like what you have going on with Basketball Insiders, what Bill has going on with his mentorship group and all that stuff. And so still trying to develop my skills. Like I'm 31 now. Like I'm not close to where I want to be professionally.
Sure.
And I want to continue developing in those ways. So I'm looking for like, what's next for me? Really, that's a great question. I don't know. I just want to continue to push kind of the envelope of where we're at and what the standard is here.
Yeah. I love it, man. Well, E, this has been amazing, dude. I truly appreciate your time. Like I said, not a lot of downtime in your world. So I appreciate you getting on the call here today. Where can my listeners find out more about you and the work that you're doing?
Yeah, I think the best place is, or at least I'm more active than anything. That's dropped off a little bit, but I'm more active on Instagram than anything. If you look at me on there, it's at eph.24. And then outside of that, if you would like to send me an email, erikhudd@gmail.com, and I'm usually pretty good about getting back on that as well. So
perfect.
Or they can just go through you. I mean, I see you, I try to see you more regularly now, but it hit or miss on the schedule.
Yeah, the first year or two, man, was rough for you. I feel like you were just a lot going on, and I mean, obviously we were moving and trying to get everything sorted out there, so we're finally kind of locked in. And I just feel like it's like an NBA player, right? Like if you've ever followed an NBA player, like the first couple years, it's just whirlwind, right? And like you're developing and you're getting in your routine. And then by year three or four, kind of know the rhythm and what's expected of you and when can I be away for a little bit? I think you kind of figured that out too as a coach. Yeah. So it's cool.
For sure.
It's cool.
For sure.
Well, E, man, again, thank you so much for coming on, brother. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, appreciate it. Anytime.